Am I wearing the exact same shirt I was wearing in my last video essay? What does this coincidence mean? Could this be the work of TANIS? Have comfort food media. Shows, movies, books, games that they like to break out whenever they're stressed and just need something warm and familiar to engage with. For me, my comfort food media is a podcast. Because, like, I don't know if you know, but I'm kind of in podcasting. I'm kind of like a podcast person. Guys.
Do you know about podcasts?
Whenever I have to take a long-haul flight like the one that I just talked about, or, like, if I have to run errands that I don't especially want to do, or if I just, you know, have to drive somewhere, or even if I just need background noise while I'm falling asleep. There is one podcast above all others that I always go back to. A podcast that can simultaneously engage my imagination and just tune me out of my body. A podcast that is completely batshit insane, yet somehow also is more soothing to the ear than even the chillest of chill beats to study to. What is that podcast?
It's TANIS.
TANIS is one of three podcasts made by Minnow Beats Whale Productions that all fall under the Pacific Northwest Stories / Public Radio Alliance banner, and they're all loosely connected in a shared universe. Because this is all kind of confusing to remember, because TANIS in particular uses all of these company names interchangeably, and the distinction is never discussed in-universe, I'll break it down for you. Minnow Beats Whale is the actual real-life production company of Terry Miles, who co-created the Black Tapes with Paul Bay. Together, Miles and Bay are Pacific Northwest Stories. Rabbits and TANIS were solo projects by Terry Miles, aside from some consulting from Paul Bay in season 1 of TANIS, and as such, they get the Public Radio Alliance branding more commonly than not. I still don't know why he has to use a different name. It's probably copyright related, I don't really know. But there it is, I hope that's an explanation enough. The first podcast to come out of Minnow Beats Whale was the Black Tapes, which got spring-loaded to popularity via the No Sleep podcast, which Paul Bay had contributed writing to in the past. And let's all pray to Daddy David that Less Is More gets the same kind of boost when that drops in February. The Black Tapes had all the makings of an instant hit. It was basically like the X-Files in podcast form. The main character was a reporter named Alex Regan, who teams up with a professional debunker who's sort of like the Amazing Randy, called Richard Strand, who has a $1 million reward for anyone who can prove the existence of the paranormal. The Black Tapes had it all. It was spooky, it was engaging, and it built up a really interesting, complex mythology without ever sacrificing its sense of realism. It was a great premise for a great series that just completely tanked towards the end. I stopped listening around late season 2, but season 3 of the Black Tapes is one of the most complained about seasons of audio drama that I've ever seen. Likewise, Rabbits, Miles' third podcast to come out, is this weird, mind-bending thriller about a reporter named Carly Parker whose friend disappears after getting involved in an ARG with potentially universe-destroying consequences. Rabbits also had a cool concept and a solid hook, but to my knowledge it's never getting a second season. And that is because, like the Black Tapes, it fucking tanked around the midway point. Both of these projects are generally liked better than TANIS by the majority of people, but both of them also ended up with really polarizing and disappointing conclusions. TANIS is this weird middle child of the family. It started off as a Black Tapes spin-off, which is really confusing because there's a character called TANIS in the Black Tapes, and he's not the host of TANIS. TANIS is completely unrelated to any other TANISes that you may have heard of. Unlike Rabbits and the Black Tapes, however, TANIS was nearly impossible to elevator pitch to anybody who isn't already primed to receive information about very weird, surreal media. So, what is TANIS about? Well, it's complicated. Nick Silver, real human radio host who only sounds exactly like Terry Miles because they're cousins, I swear, decides that there isn't enough mystery in the world, so he goes on a quest to find the most niche, obscure conspiracy theory that he can find. And what he finds is the myth of TANIS. And what exactly is the myth of TANIS? Oh boy, the show's almost on its fifth season, and I don't think they know. The best I can try and describe it is it's like this migrating place in the woods that sort of warps reality around it and contains all of these sort of eldritch beings, and it's maybe another dimension, but it's maybe also the Earth's, like, antibodies against environmental destruction. And it changes people, like it drives them to commit violence or it replaces them with clones, and it may also contain the secret to life, and TANIS might also be a person or have been a person in the past. And TANIS is also, within the fiction, loosely responsible for every weird thing that Terry Miles saw online and thought was cool. When I described TANIS to my mate Gus, he responded to my probably about 15-minute attempt with, "Oh, so it's like a fantasy story, but it's just the lore." And honestly, that's about it. It is like a fantasy story where everything is just weird lore. So you might see, then, why TANIS is a lot of people's least favorite Minobeats Whale production. I am here to tell you why it's actually the best. So at the No Sleep Live Tour in Boston earlier this year, I was sitting at a table at a pub with Henry and a few of our friends that work on the show. It was about 11:30 at night, we were all passing around a bowl of goat curry sauce, and since the topic was on other podcasts that we listened to other than No Sleep, I was trying to explain TANIS. And Dan, one of the other No Sleep guys who was at another table, he comes over, slams his beer down on the table and says, "Are we talking about TANIS? I fucking love TANIS. TANIS is the worst thing I've ever heard." And I knew in that moment that he got it. I describe TANIS sometimes as being so bad it's good, but it's not just that. Because TANIS is actually, like, a competently made podcast. But it is not a good podcast. What it is an utterly bamboozling podcast. And that's why it keeps drawing me back in. You know the conspiracy wall that I made for the intro of this video? That's a recreation of an actual thing that I unironically made while season 1 and 2 of TANIS were airing. No other podcast has driven me to such bafflement and confusion that I have felt the need to make a piece of art to help me understand it better. So, does TANIS even have a plot? Well, yes and no. In TANIS, Terry Miles takes a very zen approach to storytelling. The plot forms almost as if by accident, organically, around a bunch of disconnected anecdotes and real-world information that Miles has, Frankenstein-like, grafted onto his TANIS mythology to make it more extensive and credible. Here's a list, by no means exhaustive, of things that, in-universe, are implied to either be connected to or caused by TANIS. Jack the Ripper, the Voynich Manuscript, Cicada 3301, Aleister Crowley, Charles Manson, Kurt Cobain's suicide, Lyle Stevick, Alyssa Lam, Nicholas Flamel, that period of time where people were finding severed feet on a beach in Vancouver and nobody knew where they were coming from. The degree of insane connections that are drawn between real-life events and the fictional lore of TANIS is such that a common joke among me and my housemates is to just declare things like TANIS shot Tupac, TANIS did 9/11. If Terry Miles put that in the actual show, I wouldn't even be surprised. So, if TANIS is such a hot mess of a series, why do I willingly and joyfully go back to listen to all 4 seasons over and over and over again every single time I have to travel anywhere? Why is it so insanely popular that, as of the year of our Lord 2019, it's not only getting a 5th, count 'em, 5th season, but a potential TV adaptation? I think the key lies in the uniqueness of the atmosphere and how that relates to the very fact that TANIS is so enticingly and indescribably insane. Aside from the garden path plot structure, aside from the bonkers level of intertextuality, and aside from even the confusing nature of TANIS itself, there are so many little, subtly confusing elements to the series. For example, at different points, 2 seasons apart, Nick Silver meets 2 separate dogs that are both named Monkey, and I don't know if that's meant to be an Easter egg, like we're supposed to know that they're the same dog, or if Nick's dog in real life is named Monkey and he just thought that was a really good name for a dog and then he used it twice without realizing that he'd done it. There are also multiple points where it's like clearly meant to be set contemporaneously, but they refer to things and people from the 90s as if they happened like 20 minutes ago. And the way people speak in the show is just off. Like, there's a character named Paul who is in the Cult of TANIS, and Nick Silver calls him Cult of TANIS Paul every single time, like that's his government name, as if there's another Paul in the series that we could get him confused with. There isn't. There's only one Paul, and it's Cult of TANIS Paul. There's also this scene where they read out what's meant to be a union complaint from a maintenance worker, and it's written in the most weirdly purple prose that just doesn't suit the situation or context at all. Whereas on another podcast, little weird things like this would piss me off, in TANIS, all of the errors and inconsistencies feel correct. The general atmosphere of the show is one of being in a kind of hypnotic fugue state, So it feels less like bad writing and more like how things don't look like themselves when you're dreaming. The sound design and music really sell this vibe more than anything else. TANIS has this original music that's very chill and sort of jazzy. The way Miles mixes sound effects also gives this show a very surreal quality. The soundscape of TANIS is peppered with unintelligible snippets of radio signals, soft typewriter and distant thunder sound effects, and the occasional crow call, all treated with this gentle reverb that makes it all sound very intentionally unreal. Nick Silver, he's a real person, he really is. Nick Silver has a really calming voice on top of that. He reads the narration in a way that even when he's describing really fucked up shit, like people scooping their eyes out with spoons or like people killing their families or whatever, he sounds insanely calming. And none of the other actors really ever raise their voices either. The audio levels are consistently very chill. The very relaxed atmosphere mixed with the general weirdness of the content makes the whole series feel like a dream. And when I listen to TANIS, my soul leaves my body a little bit, but it's not in a bad way, it's in like a meditative way. So, why do I think it's the best Pacific Northwest Stories podcast? I mean, I've just explained why I like it, but I literally said back there at one point that it's not good. Well, TANIS will never disappoint you. You're either gonna like TANIS or you won't, and you're probably never going to change your opinion on it, whatever it is. See, The Black Tapes and Rabbits started with straightforward premises and ended with confusion and disappointment, but TANIS... TANIS was confusing nonsense from day one. And because of that, there's no jump the shark. Because the first episode was when they jumped the shark. The whole podcast is shark jumping. To the point where... you know where you stand every episode. And there's no way that it will ever disappoint you. So that's my feelings on TANIS, summed up in however long this video is. I hope everybody's having a great holiday season, and,
keep looking.